Good morning. Welcome to the Humanitarian Health Initiatives Seminar Series at the Gilling School of Global Public Health. My name is Suzanne Maman, and I'm the Associate Dean for Global Health here at Gillings. I'm thrilled to get us started today with this seminar by doing the introduction of our speakers. Before I do that, I want to take a moment for a land acknowledgement to recognize the Gilling School is located on the beautiful Chapel Hill campus of the University of North Carolina. Long before the campus existed, there were teachers, students, elders, and youth inhabiting the spaces we enjoy today, trading knowledge and goods with one another. North Carolina is home to the Okanichi, Lumbee, Kahari, Haliwa Saponi, Eastern Band of Cherokee, Meherrin, Tuscarora, Saponi, and the Waccamaw-Shuan Nations, along with many other Indigenous peoples living in both tribal homeland and urban settings. We acknowledge and give thanks to the first peoples of this land and their descendants. It's also important to acknowledge and honor the crucial role of enslaved people in the early days of this campus. Enslaved people were sold as escheated property to help fund the establishment of UNC, and the labor of enslaved people built UNC Chapel Hill and undergirded its operations until emancipation. We acknowledge and give thanks to the enslaved people who built UNC and to their descendants. The Gillings Humanitarian Health Initiative is an effort to increase our impact with the collective efforts of faculty and students through research, awareness building and education, capacity building and technical support, engagement and service projects, and advocacy and influencing of policy and practice. As part of the Humanitarian Health Initiative, the seminar series brings those who work in humanitarian health to the Gilling School to share their experiences in the field. Today's seminar is entitled Safety and Security of Healthcare Facilities and Workers in Humanitarian Settings. And we're lucky enough to be joined by three speakers who are experts in this topic. Dr. Dilshad Jaff is an adjunct associate professor and a humanitarian fellow at the Gilling School of Global Public Health. He holds a master's of public health degree from Gillings and has more than 20 years of field experience in complex humanitarian crises, working for refugees and IDPs, largely with the International Committee of the Red Cross in the Middle East and Africa. He has experience in designing, implementing, supervising, and monitoring humanitarian interventions during and after complex emergency. In addition to his formal studies in medicine and public health, he studied medical microbiology with considerable training in conflict resolution as a Rotary Peace Fellow. Dr. Benjamin Mason Meier is a professor of global health policy at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Dr. Meier's interdisciplinary research at the intersection of global health, international law, and public policy examines rights-based approaches to health. Working collaboratively across the university's Department of Public Policy and Gilling School of Global Public Health, Dr. Meier has written over 100 articles on the development, evolution, and application of human rights in global health. Shashika Bandara is a doctoral student focusing on global health policy at McGill University. Shashika has worked in the post-conflict zones in Sri Lanka with communities affected by both armed conflict and natural disasters. He holds a master's degree in global health from Duke University and is formerly a policy associate at the Center for Policy Impact and Global Health at the Duke Global Health Institute. We'll start with short presentations from Drs. Jaff and Meier and Shashika and have about 30 minutes of Q&A time. We'll be asking questions that you all have submitted when you registered for the seminar. If you'd like to ask further questions, please use the Q&A functions and we'll see if we have time to answer those. So at this time, I'll turn it over to Dr. Jaff.
Thank you so much for that helpful series of approaches in addressing this complex issue. And thank you to Dean Maman for your helpful introduction of this necessary panel discussion. We recognize that violence against healthcare systems is an assault on public health, on human rights. And I'm inspired to see this focus as part of the programming of the Gillings Humanitarian Health Initiative and its groundbreaking work to begin to address these issues through a public health lens. Despite the evolution of international legal standards to protect health workers and ensure the delivery of healthcare in times of conflict, we recognize that attacks against health systems have continued across the world, violating humanitarian law, undermining human rights, and threatening public health. The persistence of these attacks against healthcare, especially in humanitarian crises, has prompted global institutions to develop systematic monitoring mechanisms in an effort to facilitate accountability for these harms, in an effort to protect health workers from being harmed for their healing efforts. And we look forward to discussing one of these accountability mechanisms today, focused on monitoring, as Dr. Jaff said, through the World Health Organization's surveillance system on attacks on healthcare. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I'm Benjamin Meier. I'm a professor of global health policy here at UNC. And building from Dr. Jaff's necessary description of these threats on the ground, I hope to continue the conversation with Shashika by examining global governance efforts at the World Health Organization to redress this harm, examining the development of WHO's surveillance system on attacks on healthcare, the SSA, as a systematic mechanism to collect and to disseminate data, to monitor data concerning attacks on healthcare systems. As we move to the next slide, we recognize that our research has sought to understand how this monitoring system could better facilitate accountability for attacks on healthcare, could better protect health workers in times of conflict. And in this brief overview of our work, we hope to examine the development and the implementation of WHO's SSA initiative as a systematic mechanism to monitor attacks on healthcare in complex humanitarian emergencies, beginning in the legal frameworks that have arisen to protect health workers from harm. I'll begin by speaking about the evolution of international humanitarian law, including the Geneva Conventions that Dr. Jaff mentioned. Humanitarian law to establish international legal protections for health workers and to ensure the delivery of healthcare services in times of conflict. And yet these international legal standards have failed to prevent attacks on healthcare, with bombings of hospitals and attacks on health workers serving as a painful reminder of our legal failures. No international law has stopped this. No fence has stopped this. And so we recognize the need to monitor these threats to healthcare systems as a foundation to facilitate accountability for those who would commit these harms. And in responding to this imperative for monitoring, I'll then examine the development of the SSA as the systematic mechanism to monitor attacks on healthcare in complex humanitarian emergencies, and to do so through the World Health Organization. Although the SSA provides a foundation for monitoring attacks, however, it remains unclear in the implementation of the SSA, whether it has collected the necessary data, categorized these data appropriately, and disseminated specific information that is necessary to facilitate human rights accountability. And I'll turn it over to Shashika to discuss these limitations and to analyze the challenges that are faced by WHO in monitoring these attacks on healthcare. And so I begin by recognizing, as we move to the next slide, that international humanitarian law has long developed obligations to prevent harm to health workers. Although armed combatants actively contribute to war, and in doing so, armed combatants relinquish their right not to be killed in the scope of combat, health workers do not. And as a result, the targeting of health workers has come to be formally prohibited under international humanitarian law. Beginning in the 19th century under what would become the international, the ICRC, what we call the Red Cross in the United States, international humanitarian law has evolved to solidify a wide array of protections for health workers on and off the battlefield, shaped by the Geneva Conventions, by two world wars, and by advancements in our ethical norms. In furthering international efforts to promote justice in war after the vast injustices of the Second World War, the development of the 1949 Geneva Conventions established the principal post-war system of international humanitarian law, granting comprehensive protection to military medical units, operations, and personnel at all times, and providing unprecedented safeguards to health workers and humanitarian organizations in times of war. And yet attacks on healthcare have continued by both state actors and non-state actors, threatening health and human rights, but striking beyond the reach of our international laws. As efforts to mitigate these attacks against healthcare have begun to take shape within global institutions, NGOs have begun to recognize the need for monitoring as a path to accountability, to protect healthcare from attacks by identifying where those attacks are occurring, what these attacks are, and how they're taking place. Where fact-finding and awareness-raising have long been powerful tools of human rights advocacy, monitoring can serve as indicators of human rights violations, enhancing the visibility, the objectivity, the credibility of these human rights claims to help put an end to these sweeping harms and to redress these attacks on healthcare through international monitoring systems. NGOs demanded that the World Health Organization leverage its normative authorities, its research capacities, to develop what would become the SSA that I describe on the next slide. And so the SSA seeks to institutionalize WHO's monitoring in humanitarian crises related to armed conflict, using WHO's geographical reach and its technical legitimacy to collect and disseminate data on attacks on healthcare systems. This system did not arise easily. Civil society organizations first came together in 2011 to demand that WHO's Director General convene experts to convene a platform to monitor these attacks on health workers. Responding to member state requests and highly publicized violence against health workers during the Arab Spring protests, WHO's Director General raised WHO's responsibility, called for a new system to monitor these harms, creating a model for WHO's efforts. The ICRC's 2011 report, Healthcare in Danger, examines specific attacks against healthcare systems across 16 different countries, but only 16, and only at one point in time. There remained no systematic data across countries to understand the nature of the threat and to frame proposed reforms. With growing demands on WHO to collect data on these harms against health systems, WHO member states, international medical societies, NGOs, all look to the World Health Assembly to mandate that WHO assume a greater leadership role in this area, to monitor attacks on healthcare itself during humanitarian emergencies. The development of this global monitoring effort to collect and disseminate data was seen as falling under WHO's constitutional mandate, a constitutional mandate to safeguard the foundations of a human right to health. And proponents saw WHO as uniquely positioned, both at the forefront of global health governance, with political legitimacy to act in this area, and with cross-national data through its country offices that could allow it to play a leading role in monitoring attacks. And in 2012, the World Health Assembly adopted Resolution 65.2, seen here, calling on the WHO Director General to develop methods for the systematic collection and dissemination of attacks on health facilities, on health workers, on health transports, and on patients in complex humanitarian emergencies. implementing this resolution, however, presented sweeping obstacles for WHO. With internal resistance within WHO to this unprecedented data collection mandate, and vast methodological challenges in designing such a comprehensive system across emergencies. But WHO monitoring was seen as uniquely advantageous, providing comparative data across humanitarian emergencies and legitimacy globally across its member states. And based upon increasing pressure from advocates, WHO began in 2015 to devise a system that would allow it to collect, analyze, and publicize this data. WHO released its first report on attacks on healthcare in 2016, compiled from external data sources. And the following year, it began to collect its own data to monitor attacks on healthcare systems, working closely with its country offices to ensure the feasibility, the technical capacity, and the confidence in its reporting system, that we know that what's reported by WHO reflects the circumstances on the ground. And in December 2017, 5 years after the passage of World Health Assembly Resolution 65-20, WHO officially launches the SSA, establishing this systematic mechanism to collect and disseminate data. Now let me turn it over to Shashika on the next slide to examine how this data collection and dissemination has been implemented under the SSA. Shashika.
Thanks, Ben. So if you were to take a sort of a snapshot and say, this is what the SSA looks like, it would be this diagram. So on the one hand, we have stakeholders for data collection. And this is not anybody and everybody. These are official partners of the WHO country office. So they, on the one hand, as you can see, they collect the data and they report it to the SSA. On the other hand, you have those who use the data. So SSA has a public database that Ben just showed a snapshot of. That the stakeholders can use and use it for any purposes, whether it's reports, statements, that will help bring attention to these attacks and also describe the problem. So one example is the recent UN statement on Myanmar, which uses the SSA data to outline the challenges that's faced in Myanmar. So now let's take a look at the key sort of the features and the limitations on the next slide. So if you look at the key features, you have the SSA uses primary data sources. So the country office is primary to this. They work with the in-country health cluster, which is an official group of partners within the country. And they use an official form that only the authorized partners have access to. And then the researchers at the SSA also double checks the incidents in the media with country partners for accuracy and legitimacy. They collect, in terms of data, they collect the type of attack, location, impact on health facilities, deaths and injuries. But I have to mention in terms of location, they don't take the exact location, which is a problem which I will go into later. So all of this is collected and then it's published publicly on this address, ssa.who.int, that anybody, including you and me, can access and see what the challenges and the number of attacks on attacks on healthcare and so on. So moving on to limitations, there's significant challenges that the advocates have raised in terms of data availability and specificity of data. So the specific locations are missing, and types of weapons, by which I mean whether it's a machine gun or whether it's a RPG, they do not specify that. And so for advocates, it's hard for them to say, okay, which attack are we talking about? Which brings challenges in terms of advocacy and accountability. And the second main challenge is perpetrators are not named. So I understand this is a political challenge as well. But if we are to advance accountability and bring attention to the extent of the problem, naming perpetrators have a big part in it. And the other connected challenge is the lack of contextual factors. So how long has the conflict been going on, and how what are the challenges around it? So it's important for advocacy and accountability, but it's also important for someone who is just entering the field or someone who will be going there for work to see, okay, what is the extent and the nature of the problem? Numbers alone can't tell the picture. So the other challenge which has arisen in the recent time is the lack of harmonization with other databases. So for an example, in Security Insight, which is another organization that works on attacks on healthcare, has a database, and data harmonization is not done with SSA. And moving forward, I think it's important data harmonization to occur for accuracy and legitimacy. And as you can see, all these challenges are there, and it's central to the methodology not being evaluated and revised since the launch of the SSA, at least not publicly. And so there is a need for that as well. Perhaps the largest challenge, which cuts across everything we talked about today, is the political pushback. As you know, the WHO is governed by member states, so political pushback has a huge role in terms of mitigating these problems or creating problems. So that is sort of the brief snapshot of the SSA, and I will hand it over to Ben for the wrap up.
Thank you so much, Shashika. It's been inspiring to develop this both with Shashika as a graduate student and at the time one of our undergraduate students, Hannah Rice, to begin to think about how the SSA can monitor attacks to provide accountability for attacks on healthcare. And yet, as Shashika mentions, refinements will be necessary to strengthen the political prioritization, the research methodology, the institutional implementation that's necessary to ensure accountability for these violations, violations of health and human rights through this global health governance effort. I remain grateful for this focus from the Gillings Humanitarian Health Initiative, and I look forward to really supporting these UNC efforts to advance global health and human rights in times of conflict through global health governance. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Ben and Shashika. And I invite Dilshad to come back on screen. We'd like to have a little bit of Q&A time with you. Thank you for providing that context, both on the ground, as well as helping to understand the monitoring and the accountability. So that was really helpful. I'm going to start by asking Shashika and Dilshad, and these are questions that we've elicited from registrants from this seminar. So these are coming from the audience. In times of conflict, why should we care more about healthcare workers as opposed to the general population who may also be under threat? And so Shashika, I'll ask you to start.
Sure. So I think maybe it is perhaps a false dichotomy. So the healthcare workers and the public are both protected under IHL. And protecting healthcare workers means protecting the public and those affected as well. So if you look at the SSA or any of the databases, they report on attacks on healthcare workers and also attacks on patients and the structures and everything around it. So, and in terms of, you know, in terms of the work that I have done before, I think we are advised, you know, to not just to focus on healthcare workers, but to focus on everybody. So over to you, Dilshad.
Sure, same. I completely agree with Shashika. Exactly, it's the case. And these health workers are part of the population also. So, both should be protected, and civilians, health workers, all of these parts of the community. So I completely agree. And I mean, health is fundamental human right and basic human right for the population. So it's nothing more to add. Thank you.
Thank you. Another question for Ben and Dilshad. The questions come up. Is this problem, the harms to humanitarian health workers, getting worse or better? What do we know about that? And maybe Dilshad, I'll ask you to go first on this one.
Sure. I think, in my opinion, in general, it is getting worse. but also the visibility around these attacks, it's also makes that we see more and more. So it is increasing for sure, but the visibility also is contributing into us seeing more attacks. I'm a living example of that. I lived the war with Iran 8 years in Iraq, and at that time two conventional armies during the 80s were fighting, and we didn't have these attacks. I mean, hospitals were open, health workers, ambulances could pass by, and if there was maybe a violation, international organizations could reach to all actors and talk to armies and to respect and to do. After 2003, seeing more attacks and seeing this changing for me was an eye-opening issue topic. So in my opinion, it is increasing. The visibility is helping for that, but there are issues also around that. We have mass casualties. I mean, usually mass casualties, big attacks are getting more visibility when we talk about attack against health care, but smaller attacks goes unreported. Attacks, we don't mean attacks by just having a gun and attacking. For example, recently we addressed some issues with armies coming into a hospital with wounded soldiers coming in with their guns fully armed and taking with them beds and stethoscopes and medical equipment, the torch their healthcare uses during the night. We registered this as an attack against healthcare, despite no weapons were used. But if you are not on the ground, if you don't have this proximity, if you don't understand the topic very well, it will go missing. So this will be not reported. But it is getting worse, unfortunately. Over to Ben.
Maybe it's getting worse. Maybe it's not getting worse. I have no idea. And I don't think anyone really has any idea what's happening on the ground. And this is not to take away from Dr. Jaff's experiences, but to recognize that we lack monitoring to tell us whether this is getting worse, better, where it's getting worse, where it's getting better. As Shashika mentioned, there's a lack of harmonization across those who are measuring this. There is almost no correlation at all between what is being collected by WHO, what is being collected by Insecurity Insight, what is being collected by the ICRC, which doesn't publicly report its information. So we have different databases reporting different information. As Dr. Jaff correctly notes, you know, some things are being reported, some things are not. Some things are being defined as attacks on healthcare, some things are not. We need to have consistent monitoring by a single actor under a consistent methodology over time, with that methodology evaluated by external evaluators to make sure that what is happening on the ground, what people are experiencing, are captured by our data. If we want to have data-driven policies, we need to know that the data is accurate, it's consistent, and it reflects the lived realities of people.
Great. Thank you for those reflections. And Ben, I'm going to stick with you and ask you the concern for local staff working with foreigners. What can we do? What steps can we take to protect those local staff? What's happening in those very dangerous humanitarian settings?
From a human rights standpoint, we shouldn't need to distinguish between local staff and foreign staff. They're all human beings entitled to human rights and both equally protected under international humanitarian law. The fact that we ask this question reflects a failure of international humanitarian law. The first thing that we can do, though, is the point of both the efforts that Dr. Jaff is working on and the efforts that WHO is working on, which is to facilitate accountability. To know that if there are these attacks, to whomever they occur against, it will be reported, it will be monitored, global actors will be made aware of it, and through that, international pressure will be put, as Shashika mentioned, on the perpetrators themselves. None of these monitoring efforts take that monitoring the next step, to use the data we're collecting to facilitate dialogue with perpetrators of violence. If you want to stop harms against those who are in healthcare, we need to be able to talk with those who are attacking them. And we need to do it with evidence to back us up and with the ability to enlist consequences, either formal criminal consequences under something like the International Criminal Court, or less formal consequences that involve international reputation, international shame, financial resources. There needs to be consequences in order to protect individuals so that we can ensure that the practice of medicine, no matter who is providing it, is sacrosanct.
Okay, thanks. Dilshad, from your perspective, in terms of the clinical practice, how does that look different? How does clinical practice change in conditions that are unsafe? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure, yeah. So first of all, our safety and security is important. Without us being safe and secure, we can't go into any setting and function. We need to take this seriously to start with. And second, to reply to your question, each crisis has phases, and in each phase, the clinical focus or priority will be different. You have acute, chronic, and post crisis. In the acute, for example, phase, we usually focus on life-saving procedures, for example. And in the chronic phase, you try to add the public health part, and then you go into the others. We don't change the principle. I mean, duty of care, do no harm principle, all this will stay the same, but we need to adapt into available resources and make use of them. When you function in the field, usually, for example, you don't have running water. So you bring, like, you establish hand washing stations, you bring a bucket, and then you put the chlorine tablet, you put water, you do hand washing. So you don't do anything without washing your hands still, even if you don't have running water. We have the continuum of care, for example. It goes from the community, the patient goes from the community to primary health care, then to secondary health care, then ends up in the tertiary. Usually you don't have that, but referrers are not available. But I mean, you don't have an ambulance to refer, for example, but then there's like a motorbike they call Boda Boda, for example, in some settings, or there's a donkey that they transfer patient with. So you adapt to available resources, but the principles of protocols and standards and principles of healthcare will not change, will remain, but will be a little bit modified to be more effective in the setting you function in. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah. And Shashika, question for you. How do you continue to support and empower humanitarian healthcare efforts in the face of burnout from the pandemic?
That's a good question. But I think, anybody who has worked in the field of humanitarian work would tell you, like, burnout, they have faced burnout way before the pandemic. So it's a consistent problem, common problem within organizations, and there's a high turnover in terms of workers. So that's a problem that's ongoing. So I think if anyone is able to adapt to burnout, and it would be the humanitarian workers. And in terms of addressing it, I think it's important, having said that, we know that the resilience is there, but in terms of adapting, it's important to consider the impact that the COVID-19 has had on humanitarian efforts, because in some instances, it has sort of made the perpetrators braver because the attention is elsewhere. And in Myanmar, for an example, the COVID-19 workers were attacked when they were distributing relief. So it's important to make sure that their safety is paramount, and then also that there are measures in place to sort of account to this increased pressure and the resulting burnout as well.
That's helpful, thank you. Another question from the audience for any one of you. Do you think that the perceived ideologies of some humanitarian organizations might be contributing to attacks on healthcare workers? We'd love to hear your reflections on that.
Yes, indeed, yes.
And in what ways, Dilshad?
It's a very complex issue, and it depends on the setting, and it depends on the you know, on the organization, the background, and the people who they work in the organization and the setting, and so people fighting can easily turn this organization into an enemy, for example, and then people can turn against, and vice versa, people can say no. So it depends on the setting, it depends on the organization, it depends on the agenda of the organization, because there are some organizations who they have agendas. I mean, and it's fine. I mean, they are there to do some work, and they are there for that work. So it depends, but indeed it is, or it might be the case.
Mm-hmm. And we think about this in the context of international humanitarian law too. And this was some of the work that Hannah Rice did, thinking about the evolution of international humanitarian law. We began with the idea that health workers are inherently neutral actors. And yet we recognize that this is not true. And so our international humanitarian law has shifted from viewing health workers as neutral to viewing health workers as protected. Protected whether they are wearing the uniform of a specific army and attached to the army, or whether they are independent of the army. But we recognize that even if these health workers are not neutral, even if we recognize that they do have a perceived stance in the conflict, that they are nevertheless protected as non-combatants in that conflict.
Okay. Another question that's come up specifically for Shashika, do you know of other examples of how these data, the SSA data, are being used by state and non-state actors to facilitate accountability?
In terms of, I'm not entirely sure how the state actors use it, but I think it's majority of it is used by non-state actors who usually are neutral. But the main sort of way that this data is used is, and even when the SSA was developed, they wanted to understand the nature and the extent of the problem. So that's one way. So in terms of saying, okay, the problem is this big and we need to act fast. So I think in the initial days, this data was used by different organizations, including ICRC. They have their own, but they also use the publicly available one. And then the UN, different UN organizations internally and externally. In terms of state actors, I'm not entirely sure how the state actors use it, because sometimes the states themselves are perpetrators, so that can be a little challenging. So yeah, that's how the data is specifically used. And I think the call to action right now is to improve the SSA and these mechanisms so that these actors can use this data better, and more people will be using this data, including academic researchers, to push the case forward to minimize attacks on healthcare.
And I just want to add to that, that there's a reason why when Dr. Jaff talks about this, he mentions the SSA. Because it's developed by the World Health Organization, there's this international legitimacy that's created by having it developed not from academics, not from NGOs, but from the world's global governance actor in the space. It presents political challenges, indeed, as Shashika mentions, but that there are distinct advantages, political advantages, to having this data disseminated and collected through WHO.
Good, thank you. And for Ben and Dilshad, another question. In a country like Afghanistan, how should NGOs, bilaterals, and multilaterals plan and respond for dramatic changes in context? Dilshad, maybe you could start with that.
Sure, sure. So, I mean, Afghanistan, for example, it's a chronic, complex humanitarian emergency country. So I would assume that organizations who they function in a setting like Afghanistan, they should have a contingency plan and they should know the context very well. I mean, if you ask most organizations, they're working in that country since 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. There are organizations that I know of, they are working in Afghanistan since 30 years. And there are many, so when you function in a country for 30 years or 20 years, you should know the context very, very well. And you should have a good networking, you should have good analysis, good mapping, and a good contingency plan to act upon when this will happen. So I don't think we have a new organization who just started working in Afghanistan and then they do. So and most of it, to be honest, it's remote intervention. They are based in another country. Majority of the staff are based in another country, and they go in and out into a country such as Afghanistan, for example. They follow up and they do their work and they come back to the safest place.
Thanks. Let me just ask a final set of questions, and this is sort of to the benefit of the students in the audience. So Dilshad, from your perspective, what are some ways, what are some of the implications for people who are considering humanitarian work as their career? How should they be thinking about this?
Yeah, I would start in a positive way. It is really a rewarding work, especially when you are on the ground and when you have the proximity to the people or the beneficiaries you serve. I mean, you make changes and you can see it by yourself and you understand your context very well. And therefore you will be able to design effective interventions and help them. It's very rewarding, really. I mean, it's unique. It's a unique career. However, it's hard. You go through a lot of hardships. You work in harsh conditions, stress constantly under extreme stress. And if you look at these settings, humanitarian aid workers, you have high number of medevacs. People are being medevaced, humanitarian aid workers, because of burnout and stress. Even PTSD among our colleagues, it's common, unfortunately. And then you leave your normal life behind. I mean, less food, sometimes no food, you don't have your regular coffee, so it's really hard and harsh. If you are not prepared for, if you don't have really good coping mechanisms, I would not really recommend that. But it's good if you are doing it on the ground. Soft skills are very important. Soft skills, don't underestimate them. I mean, you graduate from the Gillings or other school, you're a medical lecturer. Soft skills are very important. These soft skills can save your life. I mean, communication, active listening, good conflict resolution skills, analytical skills. These are all important to make your work better, to save your life in most cases, and also to do. But again, if you are prepared for it, and if you enjoy it, you will really, it's a rewarding work when you serve people in need, especially marginalized and vulnerable people, women and children, disabled and other groups within the community.
That's great, thank you, Dilshad. And Ben, for students who are interested in the potential career pathway to address these issues at more of a policy or advocacy level, what would that look like?
So I'll begin by saying that the line between humanitarian actors and policymakers is often a fine line, with actors jumping back and forth between these two arenas. And that's a good thing, that policymaking is not made completely devoid of context of what the circumstances are on the ground. But beyond that, I would recognize that policymaking isn't just made in the halls of the UN in New York and the World Health Organization in Geneva. That policy actors are existing throughout national governments, national ministries of health. They're existing through NGOs. Some of us work in academia and consider ourselves to be working in global health policy. So I think there are a number of ways to become an actor in the global health policy landscape that don't necessarily involve sitting as an international bureaucrat, but nevertheless proving to be a policymaker or advocate in this system. And I think the first step is trying to figure out the type of person you are. And I think this speaks to Dr. Joff's point about resiliency and the challenges of being an actor in the humanitarian space. Is this the type of life you want to lead? And the second is understanding the type of work you want to do. Do you want to be working hands-on with individual patients or victims? Do you want to be working at a distance in order to think about the data that's happening on the ground and translating that into policy reforms? It's about the kind of career you want to have on a day-to-day basis, but also the kind of impact you want to have throughout the decades that you will work in this field. And beginning, or I guess ending where I began, I think that there are a lot of people who switch back and forth and wear different hats depending on different jobs and different years. So I don't think you have to make that choice, but to recognize that you are better for understanding the various perspectives that a career can take.
Great. And Shashika, as a student yourself, do you have any words of wisdom or reflections for the students in the audience who want to engage in this work?
Yeah, actually, I just want to echo what Ben said. So I have worked in complex humanitarian settings, and that's actually one of the reasons why I wanted to work in global health policy, because I saw the importance of the policies that are being made and how it affects people in the ground level. And sometimes there's a huge disconnect. And, I saw the question earlier about the local workers and the foreign workers, and there is a dichotomy there. So, you know, those challenges exist. So it's important and it shouldn't exist, but, you know, those challenges exist. And so it's important for people who, go into the settings of that are challenging to also come out and inform the policymaking processes. So, you know, if you can afford to do both and inform yourself, I think it will also improve your ethical understanding of challenges as well. And we'll take the opportunity with the, as Jaff and as Dilshad and Ben suggested, you know, based on your character and what you want in life.
Great. Well, thank you to all three of you for this insights that you've shared today, your experiences. It's been amazing to hear your reflections. So really just so grateful for you to be part of this Humanitarian Health Initiative Seminar Series. Thank you. I will end by just reminding people to please take a moment to fill out the evaluation survey, which will be put in the chat shortly. And you'll also receive an email from Naya, who's the behind the scenes coordinator extraordinaire for this seminar series. She'll be emailing that evaluation link in the coming days. And this recording will be made available through our Health and Humanitarian Health Initiative website. And Naya will also include the link for that in the chat. So again, thank you so much to the three of you for participating. This has been a great discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.